have David Bramhill this morning from Union Jack Oil. David, good morning.
Morning, Andrew.
Good to be catching
up. Nice to see you.
And good to have you back here, David. Your 2021 accounts out this morning. A year in which a number of milestones here were clearly achieved. What was the story for you as far as 2021?
Well, the story was a bit of a curate's egg. But towards the back end, everything picked up. You know, we had a few planning situations go up. The star of the show, obviously, in fact, we've got quite a few stills in the portfolio. With Wressle, everyone can see the results of what's happening. And as far as we're concerned, the journey's just begun. We haven't even left the station yet. It was very, very good to see the proppant squeeze and core tubing exercise work. And that was engineering at its peak, to be honest with you. What that oil field was giving us made a great, great difference. And say the results are there for everyone to see. And there's still the gas monetization and also the field development plan to be hopefully approved by the North Sea Transition Authority. And assuming it's passed, it'd be very, very nice to be able to say, well, actually, we've got the second largest onshore oil field next to Witch Farm. And that's by country mile, to be honest with you. And production, even though we're doing 750, 800 plus a day, it will do 1,000 barrels. So I'm not saying that's what will happen, but it needs a few constrictions to be removed and away we go. And one of the main things to make that happen would be the gas monetization, which is being looked at very seriously at Egdon and the joint venture partners now.
We'll talk in a bit more detail about some of the projects shortly. Across the board here, David, you made a gross profit on all sales last year.
Really, really great to see, yeah. Yeah, probably from one of the first companies ever.
And a good increase in sales.
Oh, well, 1,000% increase, that's not a shabby figure, is it? So, terrific, great. And I'm pleased with the partners, to be honest, Egdon, Europa. We've been through hell with Wressle in the early days to make this happen. And some people would have said, oh, to hell with this, but no, the perseverance has paid off.
Well, bring us up to speed where we are currently here, David, as far as Wressle.
Well, the bottom line is the field development plan is in place. Now, as one of the questions that we've always had at Wressle, we've always believed Wressle to be special. And I think we're being proven that now. The results are showing you something which is a bit different. Without doubt, this is a terrific, terrific onshore well. And there are some unanswered questions with Wressle. And one of those questions are, what is the longevity of that project? And this is what I think everyone is aware that Gaffney Cline, which is a very reputable company, are doing a lot of work over and above just a reserves report for us. And the reserves report, to me, wouldn't be that important, to be honest with you. If we didn't think that it was a super, super well, we wouldn't have gone into the lion's den. You always stand. So what the main question is here, what is the deliverability of this well going to be over the period? Because everyone knows that these wells deplete or can deplete, but we don't believe that the depletion rate would be anywhere near what would be considered the norm. And one of the beauties of this, you've also got the Penistone flags, which has remained untapped, and also we think the upside potential on the Penistone is a lot more than we believed. The Wingfield flags hasn't even been touched yet. So, but there's some strange things happening at Wressle. The pressures are absolutely amazing. You look every single day we get a report, and you look, this well just keeps on giving. So, Gaffney Cline are being fed with information, and I'm sure It's not an inexpensive exercise we're doing there. I'm sure the end result would be pretty good, our opinion. Won't have too long to wait, but as far as giving you an actual time, it is difficult. There's still so much going on.
How are things at West Newton?
Very, very good. Again, at the end of the year, you would have thought that was an end of the project. The way that, you know, with the share price hits and everything we were taking, and you know, believe me, there were times I felt like one of the band on the Titanic. You know, seriously. We kept faith and Raflin and our joint venture partner, Rarebode. We committed money saying, right, we go to the best in the world. And that's what we've done with every single result. And these results are beginning to feed through. And on a personal basis, I would have no worries about the future. And I'm just looking forward to the next drill program to start again, which it will.
So you're looking to drill another well here?
Oh, of course, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, yeah. I can't go too much into design and plan, but that news will be out soon enough. But I certainly wouldn't be concerned. I don't have a scrap of concern about West Newton, not at all.
What's your feeling as far as the potential at Biscothorpe?
Well, the potential at Biscothorpe has always been there. It's the largest unappraised project in the UK. And we're dying to get at it. Unfortunately, the planning permission, that meeting was held on the day of COP26. Not a very good day for us. And we got the appeal in. And I'd be highly surprised with the current situation. You can never say everything is 100%, but I'd be surprised if an appeal wouldn't help. But we know exactly, we've drilled a well before, we know the terrain, we know what equipment to use. So, and this well would be easier than last time, it's a sidetrack. So, we're in great shape.
What about Kiddington and Fiskerton Airfield?
Fiskerton Airfield, let me do that one first, is an oil field, a declining oil field. It's still producing, washing its face. Simple as that. Kennington, we've got planning permission for two wells in place. There's a new well being designed, a sidetrack. And I know that Egdon and ourselves, we're the joint holders of that. We've got 55% and it's washing its face in a very good way. The revenues we're getting from Wressle are more than acceptable now with this current oil price. And we know there's about 1 million barrels left in the ground. So a sidetrack there could add another 150, 200 barrels a day, which again is all on the bottom line. Mm. I spend more time now with a calculator. and it's a nice feeling. Of course it is. We feel long to achieve something with the company.
I see.
We have.
You mentioned in the results here, you're talking about the potential for a share buyback. You also discuss dividends. What's the motivation here?
The motivation is we've got a lot of cash coming in, and it is a lot of cash. By the year end, unless a serious catastrophe hits, our revenue is going to be in double figure millions pounds, and that's a lot of money for a company who's been used to working, I won't say on a shoestring, because we've always come up with the goods. We've always been having to pay our share. So that's a nice slot to have. So if you take out the cost of a well at Kennington, monetization at Wressle, the gas monetization, and a drilling well, Kennington well, and West Newton, we're well covered. We're really, really covered. It gives us a lot of cash swimming around there. We're not going to do any new projects. We're not going to venture anywhere else. We've got enough in the portfolio to cover what we want to do. But we've got everything's in there. We don't need to stray any further in new projects. So it would just be nice to be able to do either share buyback or dividend. Who knows? That's the plan. But in order to even enact that plan, you have to have shareholder vote, which will happen at the AGM in June. And also the court will have to say, yeah, you can do a capital reduction here. So again, there's no reason. So, you know, we could be in a position to start putting some thoughts together in very, very early July, because as soon as we get the shareholder vote, assuming we do, I'm sure we will, go and see the judge in July.
Do you feel as though the share price is making a bit of a recovery now after hitting those 10, 12p lows back at the end of last year?
Yeah, well, obviously it's made a recovery, but we've still got a long, long way to go, to be honest, Andrew. There's still, like, anyone can do their own working out and say this share is undervalued. But on saying that, we're in a funny old market now. When you look at Apple's lost, I think, I don't follow the tech stocks in America, to be honest, but I think NASDAQ is down 40%, and all the top techies are down. Worldwide share prices are down. We'd have to be really, really unlucky not to recover strongly, I would have thought. You know, if you want to apply PE ratios and all that sort of thing, then we're as cheap as chips. But I'm not here to promote, to be honest, I'm not here to promote the share price. That will look after itself, I've got no doubt. Be nice to see some institutions come on board. That's the next plan. Get your results out of the way. Do some visits in London, maybe even further afield, who knows? And see if we can get somebody to basically be a cornerstone shareholders. Would be very, very good for the company, obviously.
Hmm. Well, with June around the corner, almost halfway through 2022 here, what are your expectations for the second half?
Big expectations. You know, I'm looking to see a lot of news flow, which I think that's obvious that will happen. I'm not saying it's going to all be good, but we would deserve it. It's got to be a law of balances somewhere. So we've had our share of bad luck over a couple of years, maybe even longer, and now things, the sun is beginning to shine. I can see that. No, we're in particularly good shape financially and project-wise. We've got three production sites. We've got some North Sea royalties, which are paying back very, very well. There's a lot to be spoken about on that. We're working closely with the other royalty holders. Get something done there. But as far as we're concerned, our portfolio is balanced. We've got cash flow. That's the main thing. Main thing. And we're in a very, very good position to really do what we want. Like, effectively, the operators, as shareholders, no, we're not operators, but the operators could come back. They could hit us with whatever program they want, and we're covered to do that. It's nice to see activity back in the UK again, and I just get the feeling that the very, very anti-feeling against fossil fuels is beginning to diminish a bit for obvious reasons. You know, there's a lot of talk to be still be done with government and companies. There's still a lot of supporters on shore UK, and it's almost like back in the end of the 70s and early 80s, where you had a lot of independents all doing their own thing. And it's nice to see that happening now with companies like Angus, Rehoboth, you know, with their Victory project. You know, if that comes to fruition, you know, I'm not here to promote other companies, but what I'm trying to say is we're all in the same group, we're all trying to do a decent job with the companies, and it's nice to see if people knew how hard things are being done behind the scenes by chairman and directors and advisors, you name it. You know, there's what you see at the front end, there's a whole train behind, all adding, all helping, advising.
It's been nice to have you back on the show this morning. David, thanks very much.
It's been great. Thank you very much, Andrew, and all the best to everybody. Thank you.